that was called Utopia, published in 1516, written by somebody called Thomas More, in which he was really describing the political system of an imaginary ideal island nation. An island, obviously, because it had to be cut off from the rest of the world. Okay. And in it, he sets out this idea that we need to kind of be able to divide the riches. If we were able to only take from the rich and give to the poor, then we would create a system or a society that was more just and that was more equal. And we'll find that theme recurring very, very often in the way that utopian imaginations for living are kind of projected across both the 19th century as well as the 20th century. It's interesting to think about, even though utopia doesn't really exist in the physical term because it just can't, what utopia does is that utopia directs our desire. That is a place that we want to go to. Utopia is a place that we'd want to, that we desire to achieve, right? There's a sort of direction to that. And what architecture does is that architecture gives that tendency or that desire a sort of form. It translates that desire into particular formations of buildings and spaces, societal structures, etc. What happened with the industry, what happened with modernity, like we've discussed earlier, is that we have all these incredible new machines that have transformed society. I don't want to repeat myself, but just as a sort of very quick revision, you remember that what has happened because of this, that new machines have come up. You have the cities that are growing very, very rapidly, becoming more and more crowded. It is imagined that you're losing your relationship with nature. Nature is becoming more of something like a resource that you use. You don't necessarily have any kind of closer relationship with it. And that kind of creates this idea that industrial civilization is going to destroy humanity. And it is in that kind of realm that you have many architects who, and social kinds of, and people kind of philosophers, etc., who are trying to project as to what that would mean to be able to construct an ideal world. We are looking at actually only two of these locations where these ideal worlds were projected, and two locations where industrialization really kind of took a deep root. We'll be looking at France, and then we'll be looking at England. And we'll begin with France. Really talk about this particular man. And we are looking at three men in France between the period of 1700 and 1900 who were actively involved in projecting utopian ideas and architectures that have, of course, been extremely influential in many ways later on. The first person that we'll be looking at is this person called Boulez. Boulez, who was trained as an architect and was interested in the idea of the classical as the place where the truth of Western civilization lay. And his reaction to the cities of industrialization was to retreat into the classical, but not a recreation of the classical, but rather the concepts of the classical. And I'll explain that to you a little bit further when we look at this particular design that he did in 1784 as a cenotaph for Newton, who had died around 50 years back. Newton, of course, being one of the great figures of the Western Enlightenment because of his scientific discoveries. He had become iconic in many ways of the turn towards science and rational thought. Okay, but this is another example of Boulez's kinds of projects, and this is a national library that he imagined. Neither of these projects was ever built, but these drawings and these images have become extremely influential in the way that even modern architecture is imagined. Over here, you can see that this idea of a library, and a library, of course, as being one of the important secular institutions of the modern city. And over here, you see the way that there's a wall of books that is on both sides, and the central space is imagined like almost like a public plaza. Look at the scale of this. Look at the scale of the space. And on top, you have this large vaulted roof that echoes the kind of big Roman vaults. So there's obviously a sort of recreation of the classical as the place where Western civilization kind of grew from, and an evocation of that again within this architecture. But perhaps his most famous building, never built, of course, is this one, which is his cenotaph for Newton. Again, an imagined architecture. as you can see, it is the cenotaph is imagined as a perfect sphere that is encased within these tiers, circular tiers that hold it to the ground. And on these tiers, this is around 500 feet in diameter, so it's quite large. And on both of these tiers, you have rows of cypress trees that are growing. And cypress trees is a classical sort of allusion to death that he's using here. And you come up upon the axis, and then you walk up these stairs that are there on both sides. You come up to the first level, then you walk up two other flights of stairs that take you to the center, and then you enter the sphere at the center. The sphere itself is pockmarked, or has these kinds of pinpricks that evoke the night sky, like constellations of the night sky. So when you come inside the sphere at night, in the day, you have the constellations of the night. And at night, that relationship is inverted, where you have a light fixture right at the center that illuminates this whole sphere. You can see the scale of a person is like super tiny, you know, when compared to that scale. So there is here a definite urge towards the mystical, or rather towards the universal, to be able to connect man to the universe through architecture. And of course, Newton becomes an important figure to be able to talk about that relationship between man and the world. He was very, very influential, especially his kind of stripped down geometries to another architect called Claude Nicolas Ledoux, and one of his most famous works is this one, which is a kind of salt works. This was a kind of factory, and for that factory, he designed housing, he designed different institutions that would house the workers, etc. And along with the projection of the architecture itself, he was also recalibrating the way that society itself would work, looking at the relationship between who the capitalist is and who the worker is, what are the labor conditions, what are the sorts of facilities that are required for the labor. So he designs this as a circular city, the salt works, etc., factories, etc., right at the middle, and around this are the residential quarters, as well as some of the public facilities that happen on the external periphery. And the architectural style that is evoked again is similar to the one that Boulez was working with, which is the idea of the neoclassical. You see that in many of the designs, these very symmetrical buildings with pediments often and other sorts of classical elements. One of the more amusing examples that he has within this entire complex is the oikema, which is actually the place where sexual activities of the people were supposed to be encouraged. So in some senses, it's the brothel of the whole colony. And as the brothel, it is shaped like a penis. So the plan at the upper level is a penis. And there are all these rooms for, I guess, sex to take place. And this whole kind of penis, in some senses, is placed on a large platform. So this is a section that happens. So here you can see there is a way in which the architecture is imagined to control all aspects of the social structure, including sexuality. And that becomes an interesting thing to think about, because even today, as architects, we seem to have inherited that legacy that architecture can change human nature. We see it across all our thesis projects as well. The presumption that through the design of spaces, we can actually affect the way that people act and think. This is an interesting presumption that especially modern architects have. This is the oikema again. One of those buildings was built. This is the main house of the director that was built at Shaw. But the third character whom we'll be looking at is complete and strange eccentric. His name was Charles Fourier, and he had this conception of restructuring society in its entirety. And he is what we commonly call a utopian socialist. I mean, that's the general term, that he had the socialist imagination for what for how society should be. Right? So he believed that, and I'm just going to read some bits just so that we have, you know, kind of. So he believed that the form of economic, political, and social life should itself be altered to fit the inherent passions of the individual. Now, this is an interesting kind of conception that he had. He believed that there were 12 different passions of humanity grouped around three branches of a passional tree. Luxurious passions, those are senses, affective passions of love, friendship, and parenthood, and the ignored distributive passions, the need for political intrigue, the need for variety, etc. Right? So he like kind of Ledoux, but in a much more sort of proactive way, really thought that he had understood what society was like, what human beings were like. And he believed that in the society that they were inhabiting at that time, these fundamental instincts or passions of the human were being curtailed. And he felt that for society to genuinely transform and for humanity to find its true self, we needed to be able to imagine a society where they would be allowed to reign free. Okay. Again, he was kind of also interested in the sexualities of these various individuals. And there was a way in which he almost imagined a free sex sort of society. Like, for example, there were like this card index, and you could then choose your partners accordingly. It's quite entertaining. There's an architecture that he projected because of this. It was called the phalanstery. And this phalanstery was a self-contained city within a building. This becomes very important for later architects like Le Corbusier, who imagined the unité de habitation, whom we'll arrive upon later, as also a city that is housed within a building. These are four-level apartment complex where the richest had the uppermost, the poorest had a ground floor. So it's interesting that in spite of his so-called utopianism, even in his project, he has a hierarchy based on class that occupies different parts of the building. And he also was particularly anti-Semitic because he really thought that the Jews were the source of all evil and advocated that Jews be forced to perform farm work in the phalansteries. It is an important thing to think about when we are thinking about utopian thought, that every utopian thought has an idea about who is allowed and who is not allowed. Every utopian idea, in other words, has its mirror in a dystopian imagination. And that must be apparent to any of you who have seen any science fiction film. One of these his devotees or his pupils built such a phalanstery. It's called the Familistery at Guise, designed by a person called Gaudin. There is a film on this available on YouTube. I'll put a link in the chat box maybe at the end of class that you all can watch. It's a film on the architecture of it, so it's quite an interesting one to look at. But this was the story in France. These have been extremely influential around the world. Ideas like the phalanstery, a lot of these characters, these ideas were exported to the United States of America. There were many utopian communities built there, etc. But now we'll go across to England. And I'm kind of going to skip these two slides and talk about a few more individuals here. Also utopian socialists and looking at and very often echoing much of the similar concerns that you will see in Fourier and in Ledoux. Okay. The first character that we'll be looking at, and these are very interesting and important for us because in India, because of the fact that we were colonized primarily by the British, many of these ideas actually had a close relationship with what was happening to us. Robert Owen was one of those rich textile manufacturers. He was, he ran factories. He was a manager of a large textile mill in New Lanark, Scotland. But he was also a guy who cared for this idea of society and wanted to do something for it. He wrote a famous essay in 1913 called A New View of Society, or essay on the principle of the formation of the human character. Again, you see the close relationship that is being imagined between space and human character. Okay. The correct formations of people's characters called for placing them under proper environmental influences, physical, moral, and social. And to do this, he proposed that communities of 1,200 people should settle on land. Okay, and these communities should be separated from each other, and the land around each of these communities could be used as agricultural land by that community. This is a drawing of these villages. These are the, it's interesting to call them the agricultural and manufacturing villages of unity and mutual cooperation. That's the name that he gave them. And if you see, they echo both the plans of Shaw, the Ladoux's plans for the salt works, as well as the phalanstery, a self-contained unit with administrative buildings that are there at the center, some agricultural land that's tilled on the outskirts of it, and housing that encircles it. On the edges of it, they look like, I guess this would probably be the industry that would then be placed on the outside of that self-contained community. And of course, there's one over here, then there's one a little further, then a little further away, a certain distance away. You'll see an echo of that within the Garden Cities program that we will see a little later on. Okay. These are the plans of and some drawings of one of these villages of unity and mutual cooperation. But one has to think about I should have actually put these slides a little earlier just to contextualize what is happening in England in this time. The Queen Victoria comes to power on the 20th of June, 1837. And this 1837 to the end of the century, which is 1900, is commonly known as the Victorian era. And it's also the period when the British Raj actually gets control over the subcontinent. The Victorian era is famously known as an era of rapid industrial development, wild urbanization, and extremely density. So these are images of Victorian London that I found on the internet, of course, where else. This is the sort of world in which the characters of Charles Dickens, if you've ever read Charles Dickens novels, they live and thrive, right? Oliver Twist and all of these famous characters. This is the sort of world in which they're imagining, where people from rural England have thronged to the city. They're living in these crowded, terrible sorts of situations. Their humanity, it is imagined, is being drained by these inhuman conditions. And therefore, we need to do something about them. And who should know what to do about them except the upper classes, because the upper classes, you know, they know what they need. So this sort of paternalistic imagination that you can see in both Robert Owen and many of the utopian socialists will be deeply embedded in many of the solutions that we are seeing across this class. This is also the period in which there's a cholera outbreak within London. And one of the things that happens with the cholera outbreak, and this is a very famous map that is made by a person called John Snow in 1854, is that he then says that he makes this interesting map that looks at the cases of cholera in different buildings within London, and also looks at the places where there is overflowing sewage, etc. So he then starts making a connection that actually cholera is a result of bad living conditions. Therefore, we need to improve the living conditions of the working masses so that then one can kind of make a better society. So the focus then definitely moves towards the design of spaces, where the design of spaces then becomes directly related to the health of the individual. You also have many people, many architects, individuals who are mapping this city, trying to understand the way that people are living in these cities, because they look like horrific conditions. And you have books like this, which is How the Other Half Lives by Jacob Riis, which is New York in 1890, a set of photographs that are documenting the way that people are living in these horrific conditions. And you also have this book, which is 1889, written drawn by George Sims, which is called How the Poor Live, and the name is An Horrible London. So there's a way in which London itself becomes a representative of all the evils of kind of industrial society and becomes the crucible where lots of these experiments for what does it mean to make a better society take place. Okay. This is just some kind of idea about the influence of the Victorian era on the other arts. These are paintings by J.M.W. Turner. And these are paintings that that have become very famous because they document the industrial era and the way it felt for a lot of people. This is a famous painting that's called The Fighting Temerain, in which a tiny tugboat, which is runs on steam, is pulling a much larger kind of vehicle that's a sailboat. So it's really in many ways talking about this new industrial era that has transformed technology and is transforming society very fast. And even in the way that it's painted with these brush strokes where the sun is like a kind of is fury, there is a tumultuous kind of movement in on the of wind, waves, water. There's a certain way in which that the wildness of nature and the ability of human beings to be able to respond and be part of it is evoked in these paintings. This is another painting that's called Steamboat of a Harbor's Mouth. And you can hardly see the steamboat as it's so much a part of this entire sort of movement of water, wind and sky. Okay. Another famous painting is Rain, Steam and Speed, the Great Western Railway. And here you can see the train literally coming out of almost nothing and kind of, speeding along that bridge. And in that path lies a tiny little rabbit who is desperately trying to run away from this thundering machine. Yeah. So these are three kinds of things that one has to keep in mind. The cities are like this. They are horrible places to live in. They have terrible sort of living conditions. Okay, that are being documented by many, many people. And at the same time, the industrial era is also showing this the ability of human beings to be able to be part of these incredible machines that are able to control and fight against nature. It is in this era that one of the most important events of happens in England, which is called the 1851 Great Exhibition of the Works of All Industries of All Nations. Now, it is only a colonial power that could imagine that it can put together a great exhibition of the works of industry of all nations, okay, in London. And the most famous building built for that is, of course, the Crystal Palace. The Crystal Palace by itself is a utopian imagination of a building within which the world is housed, the glass and steel new kind of typology within which you have representatives from all nations and all their industries that are housed. And in that you have specimens, of course, that come from China and India. And it also becomes a way in which the colonial government can show its reach and everything that lies within its domain. This is an image about the Indian exhibit, and naturally the Indian exhibit has to have Maharajas and elephants, naturally. But the other interesting thing that is also being exhibited in the 1851 exhibition is this thing. This thing is a building that is an example of a model house for four families that is designed by an architect called Henry Roberts. Why is this interesting? Is that it is the first time actually that working class housing is seen as something that is necessary for the kind of proper development of a city. This is working class housing that actually becomes, I think, the precursor to our modern apartment building that we very often have in our cities. If you look at the plan, it's pretty much an apartment building plan. You have the kind of staircase at the center, you come inside, you go to the little lobby, living space, two bedrooms, some kitchen and some bathroom type of thing that's there around this edge. So it's interesting to think that along with this sort of spectacle that's happening, which is really talking about the extents of the British Empire and the industrial crafts of the world, you also have Henry Roberts putting together this fairly modest, typical kind of building that is to be built for the working classes. This is built, and this then of course leads to many, many different sorts of projects that are concerned with housing around in London, and some of these typologies you even find being built in India, in Bombay after the plague in 1898, as part of the Bombay Improvement Trust's plans. But while there is this, while there is the sort of embrace of industry, and there's the sort of ability to kind of say that through rational planning and through industry, we can in many ways find a humanity that is an urban humanity, there's also a reaction against it, as there is always. There are people who are absolutely aghast at the kinds of living conditions in cities, at modernity itself, and think that that is, you know, really destroying what is authentic about English culture. They also think that all that classical architecture that was built by, let's say, Boulle Ledoux are too alien to the roots and the people of England. This is a person called John Ruskin. And John Ruskin writes a famous book in 1849 that is called The Seven Lamps of Architecture. And in this, he's kind of, it's interesting to think about what he is suggesting as an alternative to the, I guess just use the Crystal Palace as an example, right? He says that what we need is, these are the seven lamps: sacrifice, dedication of man's craft to God, okay, truth, handcrafted and honest displays of material and structure, truth to materials and honest display of construction, right? Handcrafted, remember that, that's completely against the idea of the industrial production. Power, building should be thought in terms of their massing and reach towards the sublimity of nature. So now, again, there's this romantic need for man to connect with nature, something that we've forgotten to do over the past, 50, 60 years. Okay. Beauty, oh my God, that strange idea. An aspiration towards God expressed in ornamentation drawn from nature, his creation. Life, building should be made by human hands. Memory, building should respect the culture from which they have developed, which means that, let's go back to our roots. Let's go back to our roots. This idea, of course, you will find even today, if you look at any thesis that's being presented in any college of architecture in the country, at least 50% of them will be talking about this language, going back to the roots, etc., etc. Right? Obedience. Now, this is amusing. No originality for its own sake, but conforming to the finest among English values. Right, in the particular expressed through the English early decorated Gothic as the safest choice of style. So what they are doing is that by writing this story, they are denying classical architecture, they are denying industrial architecture, but they are saying our truth, you know, our handcrafted truth lies in this style of architecture that's called the Gothic style. Okay. And this is, of course, John Ruskin's, these are from the book itself. Another important character for the story, and a character who becomes representative of what is called the arts and crafts movement. So this actually is the arts and crafts movement. And the arts and crafts movement takes many avatars across different parts of the world at different times. Okay. This sudden urge that modern societies have to kind of go back to their roots, to again talk about the handmade, all of these are themes of the modern movement that you will see across the past 150 years. Okay. But a character who is a name that we should know is a person called William Morris. Okay. William Morris is one of those guys who is, I think a very important character, because he is like one of those people who does everything. Textile design, furniture design, house design, everything. He also wrote a very famous book that is called News from Nowhere. Nowhere, of course, being utopia, right? And in it, and this is the front cover or something of it. This is the picture of the old house by the Thames through which the people of the story went. Year after follows the book itself, which is called News from Nowhere, of an epoch of rest. It is written by William Morris. But you see the building itself, no? The old house, it's an old house. It has a rusticated front. It has steeply pitched sort of roofs. It has almost little Gothic spires, I think, on the edges. Right? Little birds are flying in the sky, and there are like lots of trees and flowering plants in front, and a little porch through which you enter. There is here And again, a sort of imagination of the rural, rustic, as the place where the truth of England lies. And this is posited against the alienation of industrial culture. There is a very famous building that is very much part of the arts and crafts movement, designed for William Morris by an architect called Philip Webb. This is 1859, 2 years after 1857. And here you can see this image almost, this kind of home. The steep roofs, the sorts of spires on the edges, the red brick front, and a extraordinarily lush interior that consists of so many design, acts of furniture design, kind of textile design that form this entire world within which these this William Morris is choosing to kind of live and work. William Morris also becomes an important textile designer. These wallpapers and bed, etc., become very, 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 very popular among England, among a certain kind of idea of, evoke a certain idea of a rustic kind of past that we all need to return to. There's a sort of word that I'm not very certain I pronounce correctly, but it's Gesamtkunst. Work, isn't that what they call it? I'll find out exactly, but what it means is any work is a total work of art, a total work of art in a sense that it covers everything. It's a word that is German, Gesamtkunst work, something like that. Okay, I'll get the correct thing. And when I look at William Morris's Red House, I imagine like that. I imagine that through this architecture, there's an entire world being created. You can almost see that the smells, sounds, walls, everything is controlled by this particular ethic of the handcrafted. We will see that obsession for controlling everything in many architects that follow. You will see that in the work of Frank Lloyd Wright, for example, a little bit in the work of Le Corbusier, though not that much, and many other architects who come from the Art Nouveau, and other sorts of worlds, especially the arts and crafts world, right? Jin, Shirish, should I kind of continue with Garden City, so we are done with it, or should we leave that for the next time?
I think we can do Garden City, I think.
Yeah,
because it's only two slides. Yeah. So, might as well. So as you can see, there is an evocation within William Morris, and if you think about even kind of this image of Robert Owen's ideal cities, this idea of creating a community that is tight, that is close to nature, but is also connected. A very important book that happens at the end of the century is a book that's called Towards a Peaceful Path to Real Tomorrow by someone called Ebenezer Howard. And this becomes what is called the beginning of the Garden City movement. And in the Garden City movement, there's a projection of an ideal city, an ideal world, which consists of a central city that's in the center with a population of 58,000. Separated from the from everything around it with a forest. Okay, there's a forest that is separating. So, and then there are these smaller cities that are around the central city that are all connected to each other by rapid transit and by a canal. Okay, and each of these also is controlled in the way that it can grow. It is very kind of tight, so it can't kind of expand beyond a point. So this idea of containment, of allowing of the fear of too many people, containing it, having a close relationship with nature, becomes a way in which there is an attempt to manage the relationship between town and country. Okay. I like the title Howard gives this drawing. It says, group of slumless, smokeless cities. You're seeing this fear of slum and fear of the other, and fear of density very much part of the way that the Garden City is emerging. But what's interesting about this other diagram from the book, the three magnets, is that he says that in the town, okay, there are certain opportunities and certain problems that are there. Okay, you have, for example, you're closing out nature, but you have social opportunity. You have isolation of crowds, but you have places of amusement. You have this. So he's doing this whole sort of thing about what the town is doing. He doesn't say the country, not society, but the beauty of nature. long hours, low wages, fresh air, low rents. Lack of drainage, abundance of water. So he says that where the people will go, they will go to a place where there's both town and there's country, where there's beauty of nature and there's social opportunity. And of course, the solution is the garden city, according to him. This is another diagram of the garden city, which also does a similar thing. You can see the Central Park, this Crystal Palace. I never knew that. There are houses and gardens that are there. You have a circled railway that's connecting all the various other cities. And you can see the way that even this city, which is the circle, is connected to other cities through this mainline railway that you're seeing at the base that comes inside and goes like zoop across the entire city and then goes back to the mainline. So there would, I assume, be another such city further down the line. Okay. A lot of these kinds of ideas of utopian cities become very influential, especially for architects who are thinking about ideal ways of living in the interwar period. Next week or sometime, maybe in the future, we will be looking at this period from 1900 to 2000, especially actually not in 2000, I would say 1900 to maybe 1950. And looking at all the various utopian imaginations of architecture that emerged in this period as a legacy, as a follow-up to what happened in the centuries earlier. So just a quick summary before we end. Today we looked at kinds of utopian imaginations of ideal societies and the architecture for those ideal societies in France, starting with Boulez and his Newton's cenotaph. Then we went to Shaw and we looked at the salt works and the strange sort of Oikema building. We then looked at kind of Fourier's phalanstery, and Fourier is a name that will, if you begin to read much more, you'll realize that Fourier's name comes up very, very often. Then we went across to England and we looked at Robert Owen's Villages of Unity and Mutual Cooperation. And then we went to the Henry Roberts's housing for the new citizen. And we looked at the arts and crafts movement through John Ruskin and William Morris. I think that's what we looked at today, and ended with garden cities, which become very influential in the way that we write our bylaws, by the way. Anyway, okay, I think that's it. Any questions, responses? I stop sharing now.
Yeah, I think you can.
All right. Who are our respondents?
Shravan has said he'll go last.
Thank God. We'll start with Atharva. The guy. Atharva has something to say. Yeah.
I don't have a question, but this is something I connected with. So about the cholera in England, which I connected with the plague in Mumbai. So how when it started affecting the richest, like all the civil, all the government bodies, or all the main people who affect the well-being were abhi kuch karna padega. So I related to that, how those people, migrants who just came here for work, were affected in that thing.
Mm. Yeah. So it's true. If you look at, one day we can do Bombay and think about what the plague did to the city. It's quite an interesting story even there. It transformed the city rapidly and dramatically. In some ways, in many ways, in very good ways also.
And I have one more doubt. It was all about this utopian cities, villages, lifestyle. And there were these diagrams, drawings, and all the stuffs which were made. But why can't we see any examples in real life? About those ki kuch to ki actually usse inspiration leke idhar kuch aisa banaya aur idhar yani kidhar bhi in world
bana actually kya hua na ki America mein jab gaye the kya hua ki this ye jo apna banda William Morris and all na they went to not William Morris sorry Robert Owen went to America and there they even that new Lanark Scotland ka jo jahan tha he tried to develop a ideal city. Even Bourneville, which is the place for chocolate, is also considered to be an ideal city. But like all ideal cities, there were many issues with it. Like when it's imagined as if you can, in some sense, create a city which is perfect, no? And every imagination of perfection is riddled with contradictions. So most of these projects that were built ended up failing. You have examples like Port Sunlight, I think, is one of them that was built in America. But since we were not going to America, I left that out. But there have been some that have been projected as such. But most of them haven't ever succeeded really. They've always failed very, very, very soon. It's a great book to read. If you really want to read a great book about that, a great novel, it's called Brave New World by Aldous Huxley, which is about an ideal society that is formed and then slowly begins to disintegrate. Very nice book. So if you want to kind of find more examples, just go online, you'll find them. Actually, they've been built. There's also an interesting book in the library that is called Utopia, which also has many of these examples within it.
But there have been several sort of ways in which we've tried to build cities in this utopian model. You know, for example, you've heard of this place called Lavasa?
Yes.
Yeah, Lavasa. What is Lavasa? What is the idea of Lavasa? Where does the inspiration for Lavasa comes? Where does it come from? It comes from very similar place that there are idyllic locations where the air is clean and the water is fresh and we are staying, you know, and we'll be able to go out there and live our lives in peace away from the city in this kind of classical kind of architectural sense in some way, yeah. And I mean, so many such examples are around. In America itself, many, many garden cities were built. They were literally called garden cities.
And yeah. Last question.
Yeah.
Shirish, where are you today? What's in the background?
He's in Netherlands, Rotterdam.
I'm in Netherlands, yeah. I'm in Rotterdam.
I recognized it. Cube House.
I'm in
the
Cube House, yeah.
Some more questions from Anjana.
So since you talked about those utopian cities which were planned and then they didn't work, I was reminded of Auroville, which was planned in India as a place for like connection to the soul and yoga and all. And then I read a few articles about where the crime has increased a lot in Auroville with sexual abuse, theft and all that incidents. So I was reminded when you talked about the utopian cities failing.
Yeah.
Auroville itself is a very interesting experiment. I think we'll talk about Auroville again frequently. It's not just
But you're right. I mean, Auroville has some major issues, you know. Mukul told me when he went to Auroville that part of the beach is not accessible for the locals. Because Auroville has taken it over.
I've seen that, Ron. They cordon off the beach for only. It's called the Auroville Beach, by the way.
Ridiculous, yeah.
It's strange because Auroville itself does not have a beach. Nah? It's on the other side of the road, so you don't have access to beach. So you have to go on the opposite side, and then they don't allow people to come there.
Yeah.
One more thing, like when you talked about the utopian cities, there's this movie called Mortal Engines, where the cities, like it's in the future and the cities travel from one place to other rather than...
I've seen that building.
Yeah,
it's very
so how they consume other cities for the resources and all.
Yeah.
The thing is that so much science fiction and fantasy fiction works with this, no? This madness that people have to create an ideal world and the lengths they'll go to create it. Good fun it is. Who else? Somebody else had his hand up.
I had. So the question is that was there any particular impact of Victorian era in India? Because in England there were people living in miserable and there was a sudden growth in industrialism. So any impact on India as well?
Chiru, you want to take that?
Yeah, I'm just thinking because he's saying Victorian Victorian era. I think Bombay is deeply influenced by that kind
yeah,
of Victorian.
Pompeii is Victorian Gothic.
Actually, Pompeii is completely Victorian Gothic. Many other cities are actually influenced by that kind of the grandeur of the city, the fact that the railway station starts to take on a very different form, okay, coming in of the railways. So all these are actually sort of brought in this kind of Victorian imagination.
Ashish, to just add to what you said, that even like this idea of the railways, like, and how the railway station actually becomes like the entry point into the city, and then how these, you know, these railway stations, like, even like I'm just thinking like of Howrah, for example, and the railway station, and how it is kind of this really large kind of, it wants to, even Bombay for that matter, railway station is designed as this very kind of large, magnificent structure. While the, you know, it, because it becomes like the first image or that one sees when they're kind of entering into these grand cities. And these are, I think, were very kind of conscious efforts. Like even when we were seeing the Crystal Palace also, like the use of materials, like this kind of steel and making these kind of really large, these spanning structures, these really high structures, is also this kind of all a part of creating that image. And it is also like to show this thing that, you know, see, this is what industrial kind of, use of industrial production methods can do. It can make these really grand spaces. This is the idea of progress. This is the idea of prosperity. And even I'm thinking of the same idea, how in films also, like Bombay, the key image was always, your Victoria Station, and then you knew, okay, like you're referencing Bombay. And then, of course, like ideas of the city and, the kind of work that happens over here. Even like those images that, the photography that Jacob Rees, when he's kind of looking at England, is so similar to the photographs that were clicked off of Bombay. And but in the sense, so there was one, on one hand, they were kind of, there are all these kind of people in these industrial spaces, really cramped conditions. And at the same time, they were these huts where really poor people were living, who kind of formed the labor of the city. And they lived in these really unsanitary conditions. And also people like the colonial kind of subjects of colonial Britishers in Bombay were really moved at this sight of these poor workers in these really unsanitary conditions. And at the same time, it's largely building up from this, idea that, they will become the cause of spread of disease. And it's not really their fault. They live in these kind of really poor conditions. I remember when we were, Shirish and Rohan, when we were researching material for the project Ambedkar in Bombay. And I remember that document we came across where somebody's writing in this kind of really sad way of saying that, it's like in this squalor only crime and disease will kind of proliferate, and but what are they to do, but because they really have no means of kind of actually having access to a better living condition. So these kind of, there are these two sides of industrial kind of revolution that one is kind of seeing simultaneously in the city. One is where, the large kind of working population don't have real access to sanitary housing, living in these really poor conditions. And at the same time, these buildings or institutions, coming up to show this kind of progress that industrial revolution is able to do, the reaches that they're, the kind of the reach they're able to kind of go into the hinterlands, and like, again, this idea of nature resource kind of thing, of being able to go into the hinterlands and bring all this, material, which will then be kind of converted into finishing goods in these very large factories that are kind of constantly employing people as well as kind of becoming these symbols of creation of wealth.
Okay, thanks.
Who else? Somebody else wants to say something?
Actually, I don't understand why utopian world is assumed to have a hierarchy. Like, you spoke about France, there was like a hierarchy assumed over there? I don't really get that.
Good question. No, it's a very good point, because you know, the what we call ideal is very often dependent on what we think is right for the world, no? Like, you know, actually, I didn't share some images. Maybe I should do that. I'll just quickly do that. Hold on. I'm going to my Utopia's presentation. Can you guys see it?
It's loading.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Like this, right? What is this? The Vastu Purush Mandal. And this is again a sort of utopian idea of the way space is supposed to be organized in our world as a mirror of what is happening in the celestial world. If you look at the way that Srirangam as a city is planned, people say that the plan of the city follows the follows this particular idea, the cosmic diagram is replicated in the real world. But if you go to Srirangam, actually, in the reality of Srirangam, that is used in some way to separate castes. Who is allowed within the wall, who's allowed outside the wall. So in this cosmic imagination of the ideal world, certain castes are allowed and certain castes are not allowed. So it's like that. I think in every utopian imagination, there is a certain presumption of power, a certain presumption of what can be called good, what can be called bad. And that comes from the people who are actually kind of have the power to impose such a diagram on the world. Today we can look back on it and say that, yeah, this is really dumb. But the value systems at that time were these. You were saying, I'm sorry for interrupting. Yeah,
I didn't know. So I was just saying that it's not an utopian world for poor, right? Like for lower.
No, it's not.
I mean, their definition is going to be different for it.
Yeah, like I would say that is not necessarily true. It's a very strange thing. I'm going to be very controversial right now. I'm going to say this is that sometimes these utopian worlds can be so overwhelming that we genuinely believe that they are the good for us, that they are good for us, when actually they may be harming us. We see that very often with many people, even now, who are refusing to acknowledge the fact that many of the so-called ideal worlds have not necessarily been good for them. I'm just talking about, let's say, women. Okay. You have so many women, let's say in Nazi Germany or wherever these places are, who genuinely believe that a patriarchal society was good for them. So it's possible sometimes for us to fall so deeply enamored by this utopian imagination that we don't even recognize the fact that it is actually being oppressive to us. Samajh rahi hai na?
Yeah.
And then if we are not able to recognize that it is oppressive to us, how will you recognize that it's oppressive to others? Yeah. I mean, it's in that sense, most utopias operate by creating isolations, you know. So it's worthwhile to remember, even a case like Lavasa, what has happened in case of Lavasa, right? You've taken land which used to be belonging to farmers, okay? Albeit, you paid them money, but you took that land, you changed that land, okay? And you created a kind of a utopian ideal place where today, if you go there, most things are lying vacant and empty. Okay, so those are the dilemmas. I mean,
क्या है ना कि इफ यू हैव टू कुछ डिजाइन करना है ना, तो हम जब डिजाइन करते हैं कुछ तो आइडिया होता है कि ये बेटर होना है, दिस हैज टू डू समथिंग बेटर, नो? सो देयर इज ऑलवेज सम सॉर्ट ऑफ आइडिया दैट बेटरनेस इज गोइंग टू लीड टू समथिंग लार्जर. सो आई डोंट नो वेदर वी कैन रियली इवन बिगिन टू डिजाइन विदाउट हैविंग सम सॉर्ट ऑफ होप फॉर बेटरनेस, एंड दैट हैज अ सर्टेन यूटोपियन टेंडेंसी इफ नथिंग एल्स. maybe it's not utopia itself, but there's a utopian tendency that we can do and we can achieve something to make lives better.
And also, why was a Crystal Palace put down if it was imagined as a perfect thing?
I think, if I'm not wrong, I think there was a fire, right, Rohan? If I'm not wrong.
Yeah, I think that's
it. It burned down. Let me check. What happened there? History. Crystal Palace.
And I think they made it in a hurry, so many of the details, well, it was like kind of dangerous, so it's better that they rebuilt it properly.
let's see the should we see the kind of chat box and see what's happening there, or is there someone else who'd like to say something? Then we'll go to, otherwise we'll go to the chat box. Continue. Okay. On the chat box.
Okay. Chat box. Chirag is saying, why did the idea of utopian cities fail? Like, it was planned after thinking about a place where everyone can live. Chirag, I don't think that the idea of utopian cities has failed yet. Okay, I think we are in the continuous process of imagining the future and reimagining our cities. So I don't think that the utopian project is also over yet. Okay,
it will never be over. I mean, just look at the world we are living in right now. Yeah. We have different utopias that are fighting with each other as we speak. You have the idea of Akhand Bharat as against the democratic kind of idea. What is Pakistan? Pakistan is the land of the pure. That is its very name. There is a utopian impulse in the very imagination of what is Pakistan or even India. The idea of the democracy in many sense is an utopian imagination. One could wake up suddenly in 1947 and say, okay, from now on, no, everybody is free and everybody has the vote. It's like, yeah, ye kahan se aaya? So I don't think that one can rid oneself of the utopian impulse. There have been many utopias that have been horrible failures. That is true. Maybe. Oh, Fleur is saying Thanos. Yeah, absolutely. Thanos.
Yeah.
Half the world dies.
Yeah. So, by the way, Crystal Palace in 1936 caught fire and the whole thing burned down. It was like one of the biggest fires in history of apart from the London fire, I guess.
Shravan says, like a white savior complex. Yeah, all architects have a little bit of that because they always are, saviors, no? Like, main karke tumhara life achha karunga. And I don't know whether you can even escape that in some sense as an architect, because you're going to be doing something for somebody else, and you want to do something that is going to make people's lives better. At some level, you're going to be stuck with that savior complex, I think. I mean, I can't imagine not being stuck with the savior complex unless you're like selling yourself out, saying, yaar, main toh savior nahi hu, main jo business karta hai na, main wahi karunga. You know, then you're not an architect necessarily, you're a, I don't know, contractor, I guess.
Plus, it depends like whether you're actually like, you know, putting something behind your words, you're just trying without any actual substance. Like, there's two kinds of architects. You have people who are actually going out there and putting their dreams into a building, and then there's people who try and then think they succeeded, but they haven't, right?
Yeah. It's allowed, yeah. They're human beings. Who's next? Neha had to leave the meeting, okay. Ashravan, you can go last. Then city is carried by engines. Yeah, that one. Na, the what is that? Mortal Engines. Hey, was there a sequel to Mortal Engines? I saw only one part.
I'm not sure about it.
It looked like it was heading for a sequel. Harshad is saying he joined again. Chirag, why did the idea that we already spoke about? Cool. Was it the patriarchy behind making male genitalia instead of female ones? Like, why not a boob-shaped plan or a building? You felt? Yeah, good point. Very interesting point. I don't know whether I can even begin to answer that. But yeah, there is a huge phallic sort of obsession that people read into architecture often. That bigger is better, or hardness.
Tall
is better. There's a lot of that kind of, I guess you could call it phallic sexual imagery that becomes part of architectural discourse. But there's also the inverse, where I have heard people talk about Zaha Hadid's buildings like they're vaginal. Because I'm like, okay, whatever. I'm leaving that aside.
I'm thinking whether there are cities that are imagined as feminine and you know, form, in terms of form. I'm just thinking as I paint the head. Maybe in Braj Bhumi, maybe there is something. No, nothing like that.
I can't remember. This Nainik is asking another question. I wanted to understand the building, the brothel one. Why was it so literal in terms of form and architecture? Like, at that time, it was used to make a bold statement or something like that. Good question, actually. I think there is a way in which form and meaning were seen to kind of be embedded in each other in the making of that building. So with the form of the building, there was embedded a meaning. Like, and you will find that actually a lot of architects, even today, whom I don't necessarily completely agree with, also talk about that. Like, okay, I want my building to talk about the way, to talk about the sea, therefore it is wavy. You know, you have those kinds of architecture. That is the form of the building, and the shape of the building itself has something to convey. When actually I think there are two different languages. One is a language of meaning, and the other one is a plan. And I think they're two completely different things. So one can't simply make those sorts of generalizations. But I think when he is drawing it, he is in some sense trying to, it's also an argument making device. It's a drawing, it's not a building, right? So he's trying to make an argument concerning a certain structure of society. And to do that, he's using the penis or the shape of the penis as the plan form of the building. Thankfully, not the elevational form, although I've seen buildings with elevational forms also being fairly penile in nature. Mohit saying no. Mohit, what are you saying no to?
Mohit?
Mohit just type no, like when Naiku poem he pulled up. No. Yoshida is saying phallic imagery is so much more easily recognized as compared to female sexual references. Like what Ashna said, a boob related plan is not going to stand out as a sexual reference as compared to the one that exists. Yeah, well, what is more visual? Is that the.
Actually, you're right, because
all domes can be seen as.
Yeah.
That's true. Anyway, there's this kind of
sequel to Mortal Engines. Mohit says no, there is
none. There's no sequel. I got that. Now, should we get Mr. Chatterbox in here, because I'm sure he's dying to say something.
Shravan.
So there's one concept that we brought up about London being seen as this draggy city that's reflected in pop culture. I'm wondering if it's also reflected in architecture. It's that a lot of horror movies, often depending on the country, change their setting based on where the people lost their humanity. Like if you look at Indian classical horror, at least I'm not sure what modern Hollywood is doing. Classical horror revolved around like Fritz by Satyajit Ray. It often involves these bhoot bangalas that are these colonial structures, upper class colonial development. In America, it's very rural because, you know, the whole manifest destiny thing, that's where the white people believe they lost their humanity, and even the idea of these plantations of African Americans. And then you have London, where all of their horror takes place in cities. Like you have 28 weeks later, 28 days later, or Shaun of the Dead, which doesn't really count as horror, but still, like the idea of, you know, the city being where they lost their humanity because of the Industrial Revolution. So have we seen that reflected in these utopian cities as the opposite? Like, you know, the Londoners, yeah, for example, value their countryside. So America values its cities and India is kind of stuck between its pan-Indianness and
individuality. It's a good point to think about, like, at what point in our cultures do our fears lie? Where do we hide our fears? Where does that lie? What point? And I think when you think about all the British writers during the Victorian era, you're thinking about Frankenstein, isn't that Mary Shelley? Then you have Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, also written around the same time, right?
Yeah, based off a semi-true story.
Yeah. So it's interesting to think about that. Yeah, that Victorian England as the crucible of horror, or fear. Rather, that is reflected in a lot of the writing. It's an interesting thing for me to think about. I haven't thought about it that way, but I think it's good for me to consider that. An incredible poem that was written not necessarily in Victorian England, but about London and its kind of and the thick fog that surrounds it is The Wasteland by T.S. Eliot. I don't know whether you guys have read it, but it's an extraordinary poem about London, actually, especially the kind of first bit of it. Worth reading, I think. I think even aren't the Sherlock Holmes novels also in some sense around the same time, or are they a little later?
1920s, right?
Yeah, Sherlock Holmes is like, I think, much later.
Later. They're not in that same time. Okay.
Also going back, Going back to the brothel, a lot of historians, especially English historians, have tried to maintain a very sexually pure, heterosexual idea of history. So how have they reacted to the brothel? Like, did they just ignore the fact that, you know, it was a penis, because there's so much like sexual content and a very male-dominated, heterosexual kind of idea of history that they've given us. So did they ever like try to, you know, hide the fact that it was literally designed after a penis? Like, it's just a kind of extension.
I don't think so. I mean, it's difficult to kind of not see the penis, you know, in the plan. And it is a place for heterosexual sex. It was said that it wanted to kind of promote heterosexual sex. That's at least what the text said. So I was like, if it's imagined like that and you're seeing a penis, it's difficult for you to unsee it. It's not possible.
I mean, the amount of roommates history has described who are very close, adopted children, and, you know, kind of build each other the property. I mean,
I think Victorian England is different from France. I mean, in many ways, though. So this is in France, and that is Victorian England, and that's another world entirely.
Right. So, I think that's it for.
Cool. Chalo. What we'll do now is that maybe next week, okay, what we do, we'll discuss what we'll do next week. I'll have a conversation with Shirish and Janella. And then we'll decide what we're going to do next week, okay?
Yeah.
But most likely we'll continue with utopia conversations in the next, for the next century, at least next 50 years after that. Get some Corbusier in there, finally. We've been avoiding him for a while now. Otherwise, we jump into Corbusier right in the second lecture. But no, this is like, we're keeping Cobb on wait. The last lectures of this semester. But next two lectures, the last two lectures, by the way, people. Last three lectures. Three lectures, na? Janella, Shirish, how many more left? Two or three?
End of September.
There are only three more lectures left, so we'll kind of maybe keep calm at the end. Chalo.
Okay. Bye, guys.
See you.
Bye.
Bye, thank you.
Bye.